meanings are merely symbols. And we can talk talkings, you know, talk about symbols. We think that we are, what our purpose is to establish beginnings and endings, like birth and death. We, you know, our pride is like, hey, look, we gave birth. Here's a beginning, a new beginning. This is the beginning of a life. Life begins. No, there's no beginning to life. That's why I say we've never been born. How can you end the round when you didn't begin it? There's no beginning, actually. But we think that we've been in the cycles of began. No. Cycles of futility. So don't focus on the explanation because you're trying to come to an end. You know? Let the focus be somewhat diffuse. You're not focusing on trying to grasp anything, actually. You're just getting the bell is ringing. You hear this bell being rung, and you're just, it's, you know, you hear it, it's reverberating, it's shocking you. And you just tolerate it. Unfamiliar territory. You're just experiencing the unfamiliar. The unfamiliar being that which has no beginning and no end. So it cannot be known. What is known has a beginning and an end. That's why we say knowledge is, this is something that is known. The reality is the unknown in regards to finding a beginning to it. You know, so we're all chasing after how did the universe begin, the Big Bang, all this stuff like that. The universe is just a search for a beginning. So you might say, how did our search for a beginning begin? Right? But there is no beginning. So call off the search. Is it an end to the search? See, that's paradoxical. Don't struggle with it. You could say, I found an end to the belief in an end. And that's, you know, level confusion with words. See, words reach a point where it is level confusion. But don't struggle with level confusion. Just stay with the feeling. So Big Bang says this is our search for a beginning. We're going to produce all these beginnings here. We're going to really study beginnings and endings so that we can get enough knowledge to finally bring this knowledge to bear upon reality so we can find the beginning of it. Knowledge, have true knowledge. We call it true knowledge, true knowledge. There's no such thing as true knowledge. There's no beginning. There's no ending. How can you say that you can find that beginning and ending? It's not true. How can you say you know the beginning? I know the beginning. It's not true. No such thing as true knowledge. So you can say, I don't know how to finish. But that too is not true, because saying I don't know implies that you can know. So you run up against the barrier of words and communication. When people say, well, how do I finish then? You don't finish. You don't have any need to finish. There isn't any need. Reality doesn't need to know how it started because it didn't start. We can always pretend to have a need, so we don't have to say, I'm finished with anything. Words again, failing, failing, failing. So we say, well, what can we say about it? There's nothing we need to say. You say, well, how can I be finished? Well, that implies a beginning. So how did I begin? How can I know myself? How can I know my beginning? We cannot know ourselves. We cannot know ourselves because there is no self to know. There is no beginning and ending, a self that began. So I cannot know what I am. I cannot know what I am. I can only be what I am. I cannot know what I am. Now, of course, trying to understand this is futile. So if I cannot be, if I don't have a beginning, how can anything be? Can't. Only everything can be. All is universal being. Only everything can be. No such thing as my being or your being or something. No, it's not there. You never find that. It's only everything is being. All is universal being. There's only the being of everything. So this is what we are, when you're feeling, this is what the feeling is awakening to. This is what the awakening is too, is there is no personal being. There is no individual being, no personal being, no I being, no beginning of being. I means a beginning and an end. There's no being to a beginning and an end. So being can only be the being of everything, of everywhere, totality, total being. Is the only being there is. So this is what is dawning upon us on the path. And it's super important to be able to sit quietly for long periods of time to enable this shock of realization to Get used to it. Get used to it. Instead of struggling with words like in a book, you know, reading the book. I'm telling you that has its place, but going beyond reading books is very important. You really only have to say a few things to bring back this focus on the shock of realization. Just a few little statements. Zen masters, you know, they know that they may just go by and just drop a little koan. What's this? And that just brings right back to the shock let me focus on the shock of realization here. I reached a point where I just couldn't read books anymore. It was quite some time ago, maybe about 20 years ago. Now you might say that's a long time. Well, yes, but that's pretty much par for the course. You see many, many, many people that have spent their entire lives on the spiritual path, working as hard as they can, and they still don't get it. That's, you know, also par for the course, as it were. I think some people start out thinking that they can help others on the path and take away their problems and stuff. Then they get deeper and deeper understanding, and they realize, wow, no, I can't really do that. I just have to let everything be. And then, you know, then the realization, I think the reason why Jesus is such a great teacher is he has the complete big picture of it and the complete patience of it. And, you know, he's honest with us, says, hey, you know, the path takes a long time. Even with your greatest efforts, you're going to plateau, you're going to reach various plateaus, etc. And so that's, you know, I appreciate the honesty there. You know, it's very helpful. Because I remember him saying that and saying, hey, even though I'm saying, get this right now, get it, don't get angry at yourself, you don't get it. So it's a paradox. You have to try as hard as you can to finish, and yet don't be angry at yourself if you don't finish. Now, what sells in the marketplace, of course, is, hey, I'm the teacher. I can take care of your problems. Don't worry. Come see me. I'll dissolve your problems. That sells in the marketplace. So, if you were to say, hey, whether you come to see me or not, you're probably going to spend your entire life on the spiritual path. Now, that doesn't sell very well. It's hard to market that, isn't it? It's a whole different thing. You see, people think they're going to succeed on the path, but there's some sort of success. The I is going to succeed. I'm going to succeed in getting rid of the I. But the realization is different than that. So when it starts dawning, like, whoa, this isn't quite it. You know, they think they can post a score and finish. And the dawning, there is no finish. You know, there's no score. That's a whole different situation. Now, Jesus tells us a journey beyond words. And so I decided in 1994 to set the course, A Course in Miracles down and do this, you know, keep the momentum going that it provided. And so it was taking, you know, 20 years of intense efforts, still ongoing. But I realized, hey, the words aren't going to get it. Not going to get it that way. And A Course in Miracles is very honest. Says, look, the purpose of this course is to make itself unnecessary. Not going to get it with words. You're not going to get it through success. Ecstasy is not a feeling of success. You're not going to succeed on the path. You're not going to find success on the path. That's the path that doesn't work. Because success implies a beginning and an end, so to speak. That's where we're. So it's quite a shock, a continuity shock, to go from this total belief in the beginnings to realize that there are no beginnings. And how do you really look at that except universal being? That's the only being there is. Vision of oneness shows us that there is no beginning. There's only universal being, which is how we accept that there is no beginning. There is no beginning. Therefore, there can't be any end. And that's the freedom that you see. Everything and everyone is in this beginningless, endless being. All is this beginningless, endless being. This is the vision of oneness. So, of course, it's a shock. It's not the kind of shock that you can just... the dawning, you know, it's the dawn of the beginningless dawn. Beginning an endless dawn. That's the awakening, is this dawning that I never began. I never began. And yet all is, without any beginning, without any ending. This coming from place of words and concepts and effort and all this, this is just like a huge turnaround. because we believe that being has a beginning, you could say ecstasy, the ecstasy of non-being. But that's only a play on words. It really means the ecstasy of non-beginning. But words always imply a start. I just spoke the word. It's spoken a word, so it's a beginning of a thought or something. Or something. So, using language, we say the ecstasy of non-being, the ecstasy of non-beginning. Obviously, this is something that goes undetected by most in the world. They're trying to find a being. There's only universal being. You cannot find a being. A being. I am not a being. See, there is no individual being. I can't say I am a being. I had a beginning in being. No, all is universal being. It never separates out from itself. Never has a beginning to itself. It's the beginningless being. And all we're doing is we're kind of just again getting familiar with this shock is all. It's not a conceptual answer we're finding, but we're also finding out we can still use words, that's fine. They don't produce this feeling. You cannot produce a non-beginning. You can't make a non-beginning. You can't make the beginningless begin. We can't make a start. So the finish is to realize we never made a start. There's a realization we can't make a start. So it's kind of like a relinquishing, a setting down of our efforts. A setting down of the effort to make a start. And then when that's done, so that then ecstasy is there, the unstartable, the no effortness is there. You see, finishing is really trying to prove that you started. So when you say I finished my life, really you're proving that you're trying to prove you started. So when death is an attempt to prove that you started a life. You started life. A life is something that is started. So we're trying to finish to prove that we started. But by realizing there is no finish, you realize there was no start. There was no start. You can't start anything. You cannot start being. You cannot start to be. That's why there's only universal being. The realization is not a realization of my being, it's the realization of universal being. And that's what I experienced in the vision of oneness. That's why I said, wow. And it's taken a little time to adjust to that. I don't know how many, it's been several months now at least, right? Maybe 3 months or so. I said, well, there needs to be a, you know, reassessment of this. I need to get used to this. Wow. It's not the realization of my being. It's this realization of the being of allness, the allness of being, cannot start. So finishing is again trying to prove that you started. And again, level confusion. You can say, I'm finished with finishing. I'm finished with trying to prove that I started. Not even I am through with it. There's just the relinquishment of I, the belief in individual being. So the being is only the allness of beings. I mean, everything is still here. It's just that it's the realness of the allness of being. There's no start to anything. We're still here. It's just that there's no start to it. There's no finish to it either. All is still here. All is still here. All is here right now. Right? In this, the entire universe, all is here right now. Including the unmanifest is all here right now. So everything is all here right now. It's just that there's no start to it. It's unstarted, and therefore there's no finish to it. The play of manifest, unmanifest doesn't mean there's a start or a finish to anything. We're trying to interpret it that way. We interpret it as starting, then it's false. It doesn't have to be interpreted that way. We don't have to interpret the wave as a wave. Say, well, this is the beginning of a wave. Oh, I see this is the beginning of a wave. Well, is there really a beginning? What point is there a beginning to it, actually? When you say, well, the wave is breaking, that's the beginning of the breaking or something, you can say that. It's finishing, the wave is finishing. But was there actually a beginning to the wave? Is there a point where the ocean becomes the wave? Is it actually that way or not that way, actually? So the finishing is actually not a finishing of the wave. It is just bubbles. And is there a point where bubbles actually begin, you know, and separate, you know? So these appearances seem to, you know, deceive us. Don't struggle with examples. Don't struggle with examples. If it rings a bell, fine. If it doesn't, drop it. The only thing we're interested in here is if that bell being rung. And if an example doesn't ring the bell for you, no problem. Just keep working. Just wait. Just stay still. If someone is ringing the bell, that's all that counts. Forget about everything else. That's all they're doing. Now, the circumstances of this world are such that everyone seems to have an appearance, so don't worry about the format, the appearance of anything around anyone, necessarily. If they keep ringing the bell, they're really getting the bell rung, that's all that counts. And they're allowing the stillness, absolute stillness, the beginningless, the absolute stillness of no beginningness. see, if there's no beginning and no ending, there is this absolute stillness. If that is present, absolute stillness is present, the bell is being rung. And forget about all the surrounding stuff, because in this world, inevitably there'll be surroundings, right? Everyone is surrounded by everything, right? Ananda Maima was surrounded by everything, right? The awareness that there is no beginning and that there is no end is present in the world. Various forms seem to give a focus to that presence, but they're surrounded by everything. Surrounded. Go to a train station, you're surrounded by the train station, all the people in the train station. You're surrounded by all sorts of people who want to worship you. You're surrounded by all sorts of people who want you to heal them. You're surrounded by all sorts of people who want to market you. Okay, they want to make money off of you. They want to package you. You're surrounded by all of that. Yeah, we're all surrounded by all of that. By those who want to mark, you know, beginning and end. Hey, you know, they feel this is helpful. You're surrounded by good intentions. You're surrounded by altruism. You're surrounded by idealism. You're surrounded by all this, which is, you know, unawakened condition. You're surrounded by the unawakened condition in all of its variety. So all that's important, though, is, are you hearing that bell being rung, the bell of awakening, the bell of absolute stillness? No beginning and no end. If that keeps being rung, then that's very helpful. People want to know the teacher's life story. Okay, you began here. How did you begin? How were you born? What were your circumstances? They're obsessed with beginnings and endings, you know. Okay, the teacher died. Now we've got a shrine to them. Here's the ending, a proof that they began. We don't realize how obsessed we are. The unawake condition is obsessive compulsive. So any teacher is going to be surrounded by that. Otherwise, they'd be surrounded by other enlightened beings. And how, you know, where is the how is it permeating out through the world? It permeates out through those who are unawakened, and the unawakened ones certainly are going to behave. They're going to be following their success, the path of trying to succeed, trying to finish something, finish the path is to prove that there was a start, try to finish, prove there was a beginning. So of course you're going to see that, and that'll throw you off. Say, wait a minute, maybe this teacher's not so good because they're surrounded by this circus, you know. And you say, wow. But is the teacher truly detached from that? Is the teacher dwelling in absolute stillness? The beginningless, endless, absolute stillness of all is universal being. Are they in that? Are they in that? Are they in that? Actually in it. Actually in it. And actually in it. Are they actually ringing the bell? Then nothing else matters about their circumstances, who they are, who they say they are, who someone else says they are. All that stuff doesn't matter at all. You see, universal being doesn't have a story. Doesn't have a story. Doesn't have a beginning and an ending. Stories have a beginning and ending, don't they? There is no story to reality, to a universal being. There is no story. If people in the world think that, you think, I need some help here, I need someone that's really great, you're here to help me, great. So you helped me prove that I had a beginning, you know, and so your life has to exemplify that you had a beginning. Why? You have to have an end then. So they want to control your life, and so to make sure that you have some really intense ending, which highlights that you began, you know, or so troubles arise in your life that to try and produce the storyline. That people can grab a hold of. And that's what I'm seeing with life here, that people have told me I have a life here. And I said, no. They want me to have this beginning. They want me to have a life. I say, I don't have any life. Well, how can you help us then? You're helped by realizing that you don't have a life. There's only universal being. There is no I being. So the trouble I have now is that the story that the world wants to tell about me is a very bad story. It's very, you know, severe problems, difficulties. So I asked the Holy Spirit to change that storyline so ultimately people can realize there is no story to tell. Ask for miracles, actually, you have to there. The world's trying to insist that I had a beginning, so that I can be useful to the world. But if it's established for sure that I had a beginning, the only way to do that is to die. You see, so the world wants me to die, actually. That's the twist of logic of the world. They wanted Jesus to die. They want everyone to die that comes with the light here of truth. They say, okay, now we know that you had a beginning because you died. Because if you stay alive, how do you know what the ending is? And if you can't see an ending, how do you know that there was a beginning? You see. So really, the world, those who kind of bring the light in the world wants them to die. There's no question about it. So there's this huge push on me now to die, actually. And it's all for the good intentions. See, it's the good intentions of the world that are trying to force you into death. They say, we're just trying to help you. You say you want to help us, so we're trying to help you help us. And so really all these good intentions of the world have resulted. So what has to happen is that people will say, huh, I guess you're really not ready to help us then, huh? Yeah, you really can't help us yet. That's too bad. I thought you'd be able to really help us, but you're not able to. Well, absolutely, I cannot help you, but you is not you. There is no you. There's no I being. I can't help I being, but there isn't any I being. So people can say, well, you can't help me in the way that I want to be helped, but you might be able to help me in some other way. It's possible. And then that's the spiritual path. But they don't see the spiritual path as helping them. they see it as trying to get rid of, you know, no beginningness. And the more they keep trying, they keep failing. They say, wow, what's going on here? So it's very interesting, this world. People really don't see the spiritual path as helping them. It doesn't help it doesn't help find a beginning. So they say, well, how is that helpful? I don't understand that. I mean, it's... But why does I need to be helped? Why do we need to be helped to find... Why do we need to find a beginning? See? Well, then the continuity fear. Well, I'm used to this. I'm used to this, so... So what people will say... If I don't die, what people will say is that, well, you're not really helping us, you know, that much. But maybe you're helping a little bit, some way, I don't really know. Don't quite understand it, but possible. You're not really a big help. Yeah. Might be, you know, some sort of marginal help, maybe at the most. What I have to accept, you know. It's either that or dying, actually, at this point. So. So, people grab a hold of teachers. They say, we want you to be a big help here. You know, you got potential. I feel your potential. You could be really a big help. So let's market you. Let's help you get, you know, be a big help. Because I feel just like you're a little help. But I feel like a little help could be much bigger if we could find this beginning to it, find this start to it, get a start to it here. That's why situations sometimes they start real big, they go, wow, go, and then it's kind of they fade out. As momentum, people lose that momentum, and then they go into really seeing the real help that's there. They say, wow, it's way more than I thought. So, the thing is, when you really get it, that absolute stillness, is that the help is so off the charts that there's no way for the world to evaluate it. So they say, well, I feel some help, but it's very minor. I think it's probably very minor, because I can't locate it anywhere. So it certainly, I don't see it as being major, because I'm aware of what major help is. So it's got to be some very minor help somehow, but... And I'll say, well, I'm not entirely close to that minor help. Not entirely, you know. I'll give it a little, you know, maybe I'll take a little look at it here. I'll try, maybe I can figure out how to make it a bigger help. Maybe I can help you out. They say, maybe I can help you out. That's the only way they can start to realize there is no start. Is, hey, we're here to help you out. You're a little help. We want to turn you into a big help. I think that's how it has to go. I think that's how it has to go. And the disillusionment comes gradually to them. The realization starts gradually dawning. my teacher now is extremely interesting. You find the teacher that you need, you see, I find it extremely interesting. The path that they took, extremely interesting. And what's happening with them. Amazing situation. You look at it, it's the totality of the situation. You can see how the world works and how teachers work in the world, and you can get a picture of it. You see the shifts and the changes, and you say, wow. My teacher's like super honest. That's their path, which is the best path, actually, which is why they were so successful. Use the path of honesty. They're an incredibly honest person, and so they're still using that. And it's hard to believe, you know. It's like being so incredibly successful on the path that the more honest you are, the quicker it goes, and really. So you see that honesty is, the whole thing's more transparent. The whole situation is more transparent. Even the attempts to be non-transparent by the overall situation are quickly becoming transparent. there's sort of like an inherent transparency, because there's this inherent honesty there, which nobody expects. You see, nobody expects that at all. You rarely run into someone who's, you know, just super honest. Simply cannot help themselves but be honest. So this honesty just simply they're just in that, you know, they can't get out of it. Of course everybody's trying to help them get out of it. But they still can't get out of it, you see. They say, we don't want you to be too honest here. Come on. I love your honesty, but you don't want to be too honest here. Come on, don't tell us that we didn't begin. Come on, don't tell us there is no beginning. That's too much. That's too much. Let's use the honesty, but let's not go too far. Let's not go overboard with it. that's what happens. That's what happens. We need to create a mythology. We need to come up with something. There's got to be a beginning somewhere. Come on, let's not be too honest. Let's not take a good thing too far. The teacher can't help it. The teacher can't help it. It seems like. That's what I'm seeing. The teacher can't help it. But so everything is just happening. Like, don't go too far with this, and the teacher can't help it. People are saying, like, wow. You know, need some help. Hey, help, help, everybody, come here, help, help, help. We need some help. Need some help. Let's at least get a beginning to this. Let's at least get a beginning to this. And the teacher says that, no, there's no beginning. Do you understand that? Yeah. See, we understand. We understand you're very helpful here. But just don't be too helpful. Okay, so can we make this deal? Well, I can't make any such deal. Well, we'll help you. Don't worry. What can they do? What can they do? They're not going to stop people from trying, you know? Really. But it's not going to work. doesn't seem to be working. It doesn't seem to be working in this case. You know, I doubt it will work in this case. I doubt it. Certainly, it'll be tried for sure. It always is tried. And I think they may, you know, met their match. That's my feeling. You know, this is the world finally met its match. The world doesn't expect that. I think in my teacher, the world's finally met its match. It's overmatched. But they don't see that. They don't see it. Of course not. So of course they're gonna try. At least make a deal. So, the benefit of such teachers is you actually see the world has met its match here, and that's what's quite incredible. Don't expect it. There's no way in the world you expected this teacher to be a match for the world. No way in the world. Nobody would expect this, so it's very unexpected. The world is saying, no, this can't be. No. We'll make a deal here too. No problem, we can make a deal. I think they've met their match. That's the feeling I got. I think the world has met its match, which is, that's a mind blower. That's why I'm paying attention, you know. The world never expects it's going to meet its match, never expects it. That's why it's so hard to meet a living teacher, so difficult. Dead teacher, sure. So there's an ending to it, right? So there's a beginning and an ending. You know what the beginning was because there's an ending. But a teacher, there's a living teacher that's here, being aware that the world is meeting its match with someone who's here right now. That's a whole different ballgame. So, you meet a teacher, the situation is so much bigger than you think. It's a shock, like, whoa. Nobody in the world believes that the world's going to meet its match. Even the highest students, you know, they don't quite believe it. They say, I'll believe it when I see it. But for me, I believed it was possible, you know. You can get to that point. I mean, you can believe, yes, I know it's possible. I believe it's possible. And so because you believe, then you find. I think if you just don't believe it, you're not going to find it. You'll find dead teachers for sure. But the world can easy to, you know, manipulate that situation. It's better to find a living teacher for the impact. My teacher, you can't believe that they're a match for, you just can't believe it. You really cannot. It's just like, no way. There's not like a speck of expectation that that would happen. You can't find anything that would lead you to believe that this person is a, there's a match for the world. You just simply cannot. So there's no way. There's no beginning. There's nothing to say. Well, here's a surefire beginning to it. You know. There's nothing you can. Huh. It's hard to create a mythology about it. It's hard, you know. It's like, wow. So of course they will. The world will. The world always creates mythologies around those who have been a match for the world, overcome the world, or, you know, when the world meets its match, it creates a mythology, of course. But for those who are there, who are seeing it, you don't hear mythology, you know, it's like, oh, this is real, you know. You don't need it, we gotta make an end, we gotta make a story here, we got to, no, it's like the world's made its match. Now you may see it or may not. If you're into making a mythology about it, you won't see it. You'll feel it, but you won't really appreciate it. You won't be stunned by it, appropriately stunned by it. Now, the first time I saw Sri Anandamayi in a video, I realized the world had met its match. Instantly, I saw it. But I said, oh, God. And I didn't know she was dead. I said, okay, where is she? I'll go find her. She's gone. She's dead. I said, oh, my God. Too late. And I tried to bring her back to life so the mythology could not be there. Because if your life hasn't ended, how can there be a true mythology? How can there be an actual mythology, right? It doesn't stick. It doesn't stick. Because who knows what they're going to do next. I completely changed the whole story, right? You can't really put a story in stone until someone's gone. Of course, they will say they were never here. The beginning was never here. Anandamayi said, I was never born. There's no beginning, no ending. I was never born. I was never, you know, never identified with consciousness at all. So there really wasn't any beginning. But in order to come into the world, there appear to be, but you know, you gotta either get or you don't. So. Interesting. A neighbor's cat has just showed up here. Which they almost virtually never do, and they are visiting the gravesite of my cat, and they're also now smelling where the cat actually lay on the ground and died. Certain that we can control your death, otherwise you can't help us. And if I say no to that, then they say, oh, well, you can't help us because we can't create a story for you, we can't create a mythology for you. So I think what has to happen is that the FBI will say, well, maybe we can create your death. Maybe we can create a story for you. I think you have to meet him halfway like that. So I was like polarized, like I said, no. And they said, yes. So they're like trying to impose this really abrupt, severe ending to me. Whereas if I just say, well, maybe, okay, maybe, then maybe the situation will ease up that I'm in. So I can say maybe, maybe, yeah, take that. Okay, let's get into maybe land. I think that's necessary. Otherwise, very few people will go see a living teacher. Anyone who's truly a match for this, match for the world. You know, where the world has met its match in this one. Very few will go see them. If anyone, if anyone actually. So I thought I could help more by saying, you know, no, just absolutely refuse to have any ending or any beginning or ending. But the world, the continuity fear is too severe for that. You can't do it that way, you can't succeed that way. So there has to be a maybe. Maybe I had a beginning, maybe I had an ending. Maybe, we'll put it in the spirit of maybe land. And from there, then there's some room there. So you have to do that. So my teacher is helping with that because they're those who are marketing the teacher and doing all this stuff. And it's in maybe land. So they're allowing this maybe land, the teacher, and say, okay. But I can tell that they're beyond that. And yet it's still happening. They're not trying to stop it. So, you know, that's the way you have to do it. Cannot take an absolute hard line entirely. Now maybe is a hard line also, but it's honoring the continuity fear, you see. So it buys people some time, They say, well, let me evaluate this. course, those who feel that their search is coming to an end are desperate to find a beginning. So they may be super boosterish, you know. And you just have to let them be that way. It's just like they want to put you on a pedestal, worship you, put you on a pedestal, so you're great and all this, you know. And just you have to let them do that, because there's a phase. They're like saying, "Oh my gosh, I feel I can't find my. I don't think I'm gonna find my beginning. I'm in big trouble here. Please help me. Please help me." But they're right at the verge of this is, you know, disillusionment, which is what anyone who comes here to help has to help with, this disillusionment. So you cannot, you know, take a hard line. The best you can say is, whatever you do, do with all your focus, all your discipline, all your passion. You know, do it 110%. Don't do it halfway, because that discipline then gets into them, and then when the disillusionment starts happening, they have the discipline there, they have the commitment there, and say, "Wow, at least I got that now. I don't see any other way." So I wanted to try to end them all, this mythology of the world. Come here and say, "Forget, you don't need any of that." But because of the continuity fear, you know, you do. The world does need that, because of the severe continuity fear. You can't intellectually get around it. It doesn't matter how much you talk about it, you can't get around it. You have to actually evaporate it through bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. And what you do, as you're doing it bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, you're going to be doing something. So it's better to see, you know, what it is you're doing. If you do it wholeheartedly, then you're going to actually see it wholeheartedly. You say, "Wow, that's what I was doing. Which was what I did." You know, I'm looking back now, what I did is like, "Wow, I can see what I did." But I did it, you know, intensely, with focus and commitment, and I really, so I did my best, so I could keep that momentum of doing my best, doing my best, doing my best, even though I was trying to create a mythology, trying to create a beginning and an ending and all, you know, all this stuff. I did a super job at it, and so I just kept on doing this super job at now seeing past that, seeing past it. So whatever you do, do a super job at it. It's either maybe time or die time, you know. Now, of course, the iconoclasts who don't want any symbolization of anything, etc., you know, they'll be upset with me, because they thought maybe I could, you know, be the ultimate iconoclast and push this thing through without any more of this mythology, right? Spirit needs to back them off of things, because it doesn't work. It seems like it can work from the higher realms. It seems like it should work. Seems like it should work. It doesn't. It doesn't work. A the last thing I ever wanted to be is any sort of icon, you know. I was an anti-icon, iconoclastic, you know. But if you want to actually help here, unfortunately you have to allow that to take place. The overall benefit is greater than the, you know, the downside of it, actually. You can't bootstrap people here because of the continuity problem. You just cannot. You cannot use the intellect to actually cut through it entirely, actually. You think you can. You think you should be able to. I still think you should be able to, but experience tells me no. I mean, don't struggle with it. Let me just keep going here as best I can. And so let the Holy Spirit remove the iconoclastic, you know, forces that have been around me. Let the Holy Spirit remove those. Because that too, as I've seen, is a phase. It's like saying we should be able to deny that there's a beginning and an ending. But denial of it is not the same thing as actually experiencing it. It's a conceptual denial. But that's only a phase. And then when you have to go past that phase, then you get into a different dynamic, actually. That's where the real teachers show up. The ones that truly are where the world's met its match. And then they do attract attention and mythology and all this stuff that's thrown at them, but they burn it all off. They burn off a lot of this like my teacher now is like, you feel the fire, you know, burning off, you know, tremendous blaze there, tremendous intensity is just burning so much up. Honesty is burning so much up, and people keep, you know, throwing stuff into the fire, but the more they throw into the fire, the more brighter the fire burns. So people will say, yeah, you're great, you're the greatest, you're the perfect, and great master, the great spiritual there. Throw this on you, throw here, and it just keeps getting burned up. It's gonna get burned up. But they may throw a lot on that fire. For sure, that's how I see it. This teacher's going to be very, very well known at some point. Because they're going to want to throw a lot on that fire, for sure. Because the world doesn't like to meet its match, it really does not. Especially, you know, caught off guard. The world hates to be caught off guard. This DJ really caught the world off guard. The world doesn't like that. So they're going to try and promote it and push it and say, hey, you know, we weren't caught off guard. Here's the mythology. We understand it. Here is the perfect spiritual master. We got everything. We got everything set up for this. We weren't caught off guard. We didn't meet our match. You know, just keep getting burned up and burned up and burned up and burned up. It's going to be a very heavy, big situation at some point, actually. It's not yet. Because it hasn't shifted into the next phase, but it will. It will at some point. Now, I don't have to help this teacher out because they got the honesty. There is already there. The fire is already burning. And they're going to consume everything. A lot of people are going to try. Do their best, give their best shot. But then in failing, they'll say, wow, I I couldn't pin a beginning on here. I couldn't do it. Why? And then they really start to inquire, really start focusing, right? They couldn't do it. See, that's what I'm feeling with this teacher. Nothing I can do is going to work. Nothing I can do is going to work. It's not going to work. So I met my match, met my match. It's not going to work. That's what I'm feeling. It's like, wow, you really can meet your match. And it's in a way you don't expect it at all. There's no way. See, it can't possibly be my magic. See, I'm looking with honesty here. I'm saying, I met my match. The world has met its match here. The eye has met its match. Nothing I can say, nothing I can do. Nothing's not going to work. I can see, already can see. It's not going to work. Nothing's going to work. Now, the world won't believe it, but honesty will believe it. Honesty, well, honesty is the best policy. Honesty says, wow, I met my match here, okay. That's great. Couldn't ask for anything more. And it's even better that you meet your match in a way that just seems like no way. No way this...